Good morning and worship. Thank you for coming to worship with us at Christ Presbyterian Church. I'm Becky Boyer and we're glad to have you with us. A few announcements before we get started. I would like to recognize and thank our participants this morning. In the pulpit today, we have the Reverend Don Potter. Reverend Potter has served three Presbyterian churches during his 39-year ministry in Pennsylvania. The churches were in Tenning, Mechanicsburg, and Middletown. He retired at the end of 2015 and resides in Dillsburg at the Presbyterian Senior Living, which is a 55-plus retirement community. He enjoys traveling by cruise ship, bird watching, and reading. Thank you, Don, for being here today. Our accompanist today is Linda Chadbourne. Lay leader is Bob Rock. We will have music performed by Megan Fields and Hannah Glant. Thank you to Greg Robertson, the man behind the camera, who has been instrumental in building all of our online services and getting the services uploaded online. And special thanks to Carol Holt, who has been behind the scenes during the past 3 months and is responsible for coordinating all the participants who are participating in today's services. Please note that next week, July 12th, will be our last online service. We will return to in-house worship on July 19th. The letter was sent to all church members and friends detailing upcoming worship services as well as other important information pertaining to our church's future. During our prayer time this morning, we would ask that we remember the following people: Alex, Ellen, Gary, Dot, Pat, Pauline, and Verna. And now let us prepare to worship God by listening to this morning's prayer.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we worship God with these words as our call to worship. This is the day the Lord hath made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
O magnify the Lord with me.
Let us exalt the name of the Lord.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 467 in the 1990 Blue Presbyterian Hymnal, How Great Thou Art, in 467 verses 1 and 3.
See the stars, I hear the
for Scripture declares that the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting, and that those who turn to Christ in faith and trust will never be turned away. Confident that God hears us when we pray, let us now confess our sins unto Almighty God, trusting God's great mercy. Let us pray. Holy God, we confess that we do not always want to hear what you have to say. We do our best to block out your voice. We are too quick to rebuke and are so easily offended. We fail to trust your promises and rely on our own wisdom rather than yours. We are strong-willed, going our own way rather than following you in faith and trust. Forgive us, O Lord, forgive us. By your Spirit, lead us to do your will and to follow in your steps. Receive now in silence our personal prayers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers which we offer in faith through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Friends, the gospel is clear. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that everyone who believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Friends, these words are meant for us now, today, where you are, where I am. Therefore, I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ, we are loved and we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now we have time with the children, and we call upon Carol Holt to lead us in that time together.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our church. I thought for this weekend we would take a few moments to talk about July 4th, and that is our very special weekend. I would like to be thinking about the American flag, which is displayed over here on this side of the church. The American flag has given us so many freedoms. Sometimes we forget the freedoms that come from it. For example, we are free to be the person we want to be. We may go where we want to go, do what we want to do, study what we want to study, marry whom we want to marry, worship as we please in any church with any religion. All very special freedoms that came from that flag. However, we have to remember that we won those wars and battles to earn that freedom and flag because God helped us to win those wars. He was guiding us. Our people were strong Christians, and they wanted to be free to worship as they please. So this weekend, when we think about the American flag, let's think about another flag also, which is behind me. This is the Christian flag. It is a white background and it has a blue square with a red cross in the center. And that Christian flag has brought us a lot of freedoms also. And a lot of times we don't think about those freedoms. For example, we are free from guilt and sin. We might pick up sin, we might do things wrong, but we don't have to feel guilty. We can ask for forgiveness, and God will forgive us instantly. We are free to be the person we want to be. We are free to make our own choices. We do not have to do what somebody else wants us to do. We're free to be away from temptation. Temptation often comes at us in many different ways. Advertising, friends, things you see happening, but we don't have to say yes to temptation if it's bad. We have a right to say no. We also are free to not worry. Jesus will take care of us. We don't have to worry. We have somebody here always watching over us. And we're free about the future. We don't have to worry about what's going to happen to us someday because God is with us from the moment we're born for our whole lives and takes us into heaven when we leave this earth. So we have a lot of freedom in our Christian life also. As you go through the weekend, and all through the week, the whole week of July 4th, think about our American flag with its freedom. Absolutely, we are thankful for it. But also remember that we have those freedoms because God helped us win those wars. And so don't forget our freedoms that come from the Christian flag also. I'm so glad you were here today for enjoying the weekend with me. And I wish you a wonderful week.
Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will and follow your Son, Jesus Christ, who is for us the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. The first scripture lesson is Psalm 48. Great is the Lord, and most worthy of praise. In the city of our God, his holy mountain, it is beautiful in its loftiness. The joy of the whole earth, like the utmost heights of Saphon, is Mount Zion, the city of the great king. God is in her citadels. He has shown himself to be her fortress. When the kings joined forces, when they advanced together, they saw her and were astounded. They fled in terror. Trembling seized them there. Pain like that of a woman in labor. You destroyed them like ships of Tarshish, shattered by an east wind. As we have heard, so have we seen. In the city of the Lord Almighty, in the city of our God, God makes her secure forever. Within your temple, O God, we meditate on your unfailing love. Like your name, O God, your praise reaches to the ends of the earth. Your right hand is filled with righteousness. Mount Zion rejoices. The villages of Judah are glad because of your judgments. Walk about Zion, go around her. Count her towers. Consider well her ramparts, you her citadels, that you may tell of them to the next generation. For this God is our God forever and ever. He will be our God even to the end.
So appropriate for this 4th of July weekend, and we're glad that she was able to be with us, and we hope that you are having a good holiday weekend as well as we celebrate the birth of our nation. I want to thank you again for the invitation to return and be with you here at Christ Presbyterian Church in Lebanon, Pennsylvania, and it's a joy to be with you, and thank you again for the honor addressing the congregation and friends who are watching by this new and wonderful technology. And thanks again to all the participants in the service. We are grateful for your participation, the pianists, the readers, the musicians, and Carol with the kids' talk, and our technician as well. So they have done a grand job, and hats off to you for your kindness and your service. And I want to speak a personal word to you who are members of this congregation or perhaps friends of the church that have joined. My prayers are with you in this big decision to bring the ministry of this congregation to an end in August. This has not been an easy decision, I'm sure, and there are many tears and lots of anguish about this. But I will tell you this, God is not done with you yet. New doors will open, and we hope that you will take a step in faith through those doors and trust God to lead and guide you into whatever avenue you pursue. And our prayers are certainly with you. My prayers are with you and others from across the presbytery as well. So please know that you are very much being thought of during this time of transition. As we prepare now to hear the word of God, we have already had the prayer for illumination, and we are grateful for that. And we give our attention to the reading of the text, the gospel text from Mark chapter 6. And as I begin to read this text to you, I will share with you, as you probably already know, that this passage is also recorded in Matthew chapter 10 and Luke chapter 9. So three different gospels present this same basic story with some minor variations, which gives us a clue that this was a very important text for the early church to include this three times. Now, if you're a teacher listening to this service today, you know that the best way to learn is by repetition. Repetition, repetition. I guess the gospel writers wanted this story to be told so many times so that it would sink in between these two things here, these things called ears, take root in our mind. And we can never hear the word of God enough. Because sometimes, I hate to say it, it was in this ear and right out this ear. But maybe through the power of the Holy Spirit, it might connect in our hearts and our lives. And I'm sure it has connected in your hearts and lives in many wonderful ways. So hear now these words, and let us hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Jesus left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at Jesus. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor except in their hometown and among their own kin, and in their own house. And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief." Then Jesus went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12, that is his disciples, and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. Jesus said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So the disciples went out and proclaimed all that should repent. Then they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. As I begin this sermon this morning, I begin by simply saying that this has happened more often than we care to admit. And when we do admit it, it can be downright embarrassing for us, at least for most people. What I'm talking about is illustrated in a simple story told by Mrs. Brown, a high school literature teacher. One day in class, when she was in the throes of her teaching, she called on a daydreaming student to read aloud a portion of an essay that was written by Irish novelist James Joyce. Now, the essay was part of a homework assignment that the students were to be prepared for, to read it and study it, and then be ready to discuss it in class. Well, when that particular student finished reading, Mrs. Brown asked the boy to tell the class what the paragraph meant to him. Without a hint of hesitation, the boy looked at the teacher and admitted, "I'm sorry, ma'am, but I really wasn't paying attention." How many times has that happened to you? How many times have you said something like that to your spouse, to your kids who are trying to get your attention, or even to the preacher on Sunday morning? "Pastor, I wasn't paying attention to what your sermon was all about." Thank God there aren't tests at the end of the service for people to have to pass or to admit that they weren't listening. Or how many times did you say that to your boss? "Sorry, I wasn't listening." And we usually don't think to apologize about it either. It's almost as though we're sort of proud of it. But my friends, this is just the opposite of what the people in that synagogue that day were doing when Jesus preached, as we hear in the text today from Mark. As a matter of fact, not only were the people listening with both ears and with rapt attention to what Jesus said, they were offended at what they heard. If you know anything about the story of this man Jesus, the ruling rabbi, the ruling teacher, you realize that the sermons he preached and the many miraculous deeds that he performed often produced anger and hostility in the people. We can understand how perfect strangers might take a negative reaction to Jesus, his words, and sort of tune him out. But the synagogue that day, where Jesus was preaching, he was in his own hometown. His family was there, probably in the front pew waiting with bated breath, and friends had gathered around. These were people who knew him. It seems that when it comes to accepting Jesus and receiving his word and following in his way, knowing him is not a guarantee that those listening will accept what they hear, let alone follow as he calls. On the heels of this, Jesus beckons 12 disciples, 12 of them, and he sends them out. He goes two by two in ministry. The instructions were simple. They were pretty direct and specific. Jesus, as the text tells us, ordered them. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, no credit cards, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. Now, I know as I stand here this morning, having traveled from Dillsburg, that many of us like to travel. Under normal circumstances, that's possible, but not during the pandemic. We're being told to stay home and isolate and continue to quarantine ourselves. And summertime is a wonderful time to do these trips. We enjoy being out and about. We enjoy going to some new destination or to some place where we've been umpteen numbers of times before, like the Jersey or Maryland shore, or to the Outer Banks, or up to the mountains and enjoy the beautiful, fresh mountain air. Can you imagine going on a trip, an extended trip, without taking even the basics along with you? For most of us, the basics these days include quite a few things. Two suitcases for each person, packed, jammed full. The hairdryer, don't forget the curling iron. The cell phone and the charger, your laptop computer, and the cooler, yeah, filled with your favorite drinks and food to eat along the way. And don't forget the bikes, don't forget the dog, and a pile of toys to keep the kids occupied so they're not nagging you with the question, "Are we there yet? Are we there yet?" And no matter what, my friends, don't ever forget to take your mother-in-law. You will really be the doghouse if you leave her home. Well, having told his disciples to travel light, Jesus also issued a warning. As they set off in ministry two by two, traveling without a GPS, the disciples should not be surprised if people reject them because of who Jesus is. And if people slam the door in their face or walk away, the disciples were told to simply shake off the dust from their feet and move on to the next town. In other words, keep on trucking. This was another way Jesus tried to tell his followers that serving him was not just a short-term engagement, but a lifelong commitment. They would not always be met with loving arms and open ears and receptive people. Being faithful was more crucial than being successful. Let me say that again. Being faithful was much more crucial than being successful. You know as well as I do that several churches throughout the country have had to close in recent times. Not just because of the pandemic, but I'm talking about because of dwindling membership, dwindling revenues. People just don't show up. In the old days, you know, the old saying was, build it and they will come. That's no longer the case. I think the church is learning a new lesson, that as Jesus sent his disciples out, we have to get off our comfortable posteriors and go into the community and engage people where they are at. Not waiting for them to come, because they're not coming. I ask you, when's the last time you ever had two Presbyterian missionaries knock at your door and ask you about your faith in Jesus Christ? I've never had it happen. One Sunday morning at Mechanicsville, when I was there serving as the associate pastor, I came home after Sunday worship and during the call, of course, and I no sooner got in the house and there was a knock at the door, and here were two Mormon missionaries, women of the reorganized church of the Latter-day Saints. And I stood there, they said, we're Mormons and we'd like to talk to you about faith in Jesus Christ. I said, well, as you can tell, I don't wear this around the house all the time, this collar. I am a pastor at the Presbyterian church close by. I'm very content with being Presbyterian. And they said, that's all right, we'll take you too. We're not discriminating against anybody. I said, friends, you're not taking me anywhere, because I'm very content with being a follower of Jesus in the Presbyterian church. I was kind and polite, and I simply said, thank you for coming, and we walked away. I wonder if this church would still be in operation, and other churches that have closed would be in operation, if we took seriously the fact of getting up out of our seats, going door, Presbyterians don't go door to door, what's wrong with you? We're timid and proper. We're the frozen chosen. Well, that's the problem. We are frozen. We're frozen in our views. We don't have the good news enough burning in our heart to be able to out share the good news with others. And it's not just the pastor's job. We hire the pastor to grow the church. As they say, it don't work that way. It takes everybody in the church. Elders, deacons, members, friends, caring enough to share what means something deep within them with other people. That's sermon number 1.5. Being faithful was more crucial than being successful, Jesus intended to say. As you read Mark and the other three Gospels, it becomes very clear. Following Jesus is not always easy. Following Jesus is not something we do when we get around to it, or if we feel like it, or if we have nothing better to do. The times were like the young man who poured out his heart's devotion in a letter to his sweetheart, the woman of his dreams, where he wrote, darling, I would climb the highest mountain. I would swim the widest stream, cross the burning desert, die at the stake for you. P.S. I'll see you Saturday if it doesn't rain. The way of Jesus goes against the grain of life. We are countercultural. As we respond in faith to follow this man, Jesus, we live by different priorities and give ourselves to higher standards. Jesus wants those who follow him to know that something is required. There is a cost involved. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a great German theologian, a Lutheran theologian, a Reformed theologian, and he came to this country from Germany. And the folks at Union Theological Seminary in New York City were after him to become a professor of theology during the beginning of the Second World War, wanting him to become a professor of theology there. He pondered that long and hard. He prayed about it. But he decided he was going back to Germany. He knew that the dark storm clouds were gathering, and that the ominous clouds probably would spell disaster for his German people. And he said that if he didn't share in their misfortunes, he would not be a good pastor. That man wrote a book entitled The Cost of Discipleship. It's not an easy read, but it is worth wrestling as you read through that book. Because he tells us very loud and clearly that there is something required of everybody who claims to be a disciple. We're not called to a comfortable pew, to be there and to be snug as a bug in a rug on Sunday morning and then leave and forget about what has been declared. Those seeds are being planted, even as they're being planted now in great format on my part, in your heart, so that you then can share those seeds with others, and maybe that seed will take root in the hearts of others, bringing them to faith in Jesus Christ. The way of Jesus is narrow. Narrower than we often expect. As Christians, we look to Jesus for the example we need to live by. There's no other roadmap but him. He is the way, he is the truth, he is the life. Through faith in him, we are called to conform to his will and his purpose. And we measure our devotion every day by his words and his deeds. As we give, he gave. And we know that he gave the ultimate price by dying upon the cross to redeem us from sin. English Christian scholar J.B. Phillips is remembered for saying these interesting words: "Don't let the world squeeze you into its own mold." Taking a stand and living the way of Jesus often goes against our culture, and sometimes it even goes against what our family and friends believe and think, as we stand with the outcast, the disenfranchised, the poor, and those who are considered the throwaways of society. This very much relates to the social unrest, the marching and the protests we have seen over these past weeks in our nation and across the world. We certainly cannot condone the loss of human life, the looting, the destruction and burning of property and businesses such as we have seen over these past days. But what we have seen, I think, in part stems from the deep frustration, the despair and hopelessness many minorities in our society feel. It was the late 20th century prophet and reformer Martin Luther King Jr. who once said, "Rioting is the language of the unheard." Rioting is the language of the unheard. Because of his activism, his faith-nurtured activism, being a preacher of the gospel, confronting the powers that be, he not only was a prophet and a reformer, but he became a martyr, killed for what he believed. Discrimination, poverty, homelessness, unequal opportunities in housing and employment and education. Over the decades, these oppressions have taken their toll on people. And that leads quite often to restlessness, to anger, to depression, and yes, at times, even violence. Being faithful to the way of Jesus means we will not always see things the way others do. You know, the old saying is, if you get four Presbyterians together, you have five opinions. That's true in families, too. How many spouses agree with each other? How many adult parents agree with their kids? Or how many kids agree with their parents? What happens when you disagree? You're out of here. You're no longer my family. No, 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 no. We still love them in spite of that. We sit down at the table. We try and hash the stuff out.
Let's talk. Let's compromise. Let's deal with this up front. Let's do this maturely. And for us as faith people, let's do it based on our belief in Jesus Christ, the peacemaker. Our loyalty and our commitment is not with our government, not with the culture, not even our lawyer who pays us, but our loyalty, first and foremost, is with Jesus Christ. And as his followers, we seek to emulate him, led by the Holy Spirit, loving and caring for the least of those among us. And those numbers seem to be growing every day. Yesterday, as you know, we celebrated Independence Day, July 4th. We marked 244 years of freedom as a nation, a wonderful nation that has been so good to so many people over these many years. With a certain degree of pride and guarded optimism, we look to the future. And as a people who cherish our independence, we wrestle today with the coronavirus, with racial tension in our country once again, and with the heated presidential election coming up, and also many other issues, education, housing, medical care, and so much more. But in the midst of all of that, we are still a beacon as a nation, a beacon of hope, where life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness is meant for all people, red and yellow, black and white. All are precious in God's sight. But I would go on one step further to say, theologically speaking, independence is not a good theological concept in the Bible. In the words of the gospel today, Jesus sets before his followers the principles by which they were to live their lives. And from the lesson, it becomes very clear, as disciples of his now in this 21st century, we are totally reliant, we are totally dependent on Jesus Christ. No one of us is a self-made man or woman. God has shaped us and continues to shape us into the being we are becoming through faith in him. And it's as though you have a big sign over your head, under construction. You are still under construction through the power of the Holy Spirit. And today is a new day for that construction to continue. Without Christ, we cannot. But with him, as Scripture tells us, all things are possible. All things. Friends, out of steadfast love and providence, God made us to be in relationship with him and with all the members of the human family. No one of us is an island unto ourselves. As Christians who seek to live into God's purpose, the Holy Spirit beckons, invites, and calls us, even now, in these moments, to follow. To follow in the way of Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
want to thank Hannah for that lovely piece, very appropriate in terms of our trusting in the grace of God and Jesus Christ. And now, brothers and sisters, as our response to God, let us together bring our prayers, our needs, and our cares to God. Let us pray. O Lord, through your Son, Jesus Christ, you call us to ministry. We thank you that we are called, each of us, to speak your word and to build up your kingdom here among us. Embolden us in these days of rich opportunities to be light in darkness, hope in despair, and healing in the midst of such great pain. May your Holy Spirit move in the hearts of all people and help us respect each other regardless of race, creed, or color. Enable us to advance freedom and dignity among racial groups so that voices long silenced may be heard and injustice and oppression known. During this coronavirus pandemic, let us be proactive in mitigating its spread. Help us to use good common sense, O God, as we go about our daily routines. Give wisdom to medical professionals working for a vaccine. Touch the afflicted. Comfort those whose loved ones have been claimed by this disease. And guide all segments of society for the safe reopening of businesses and schools, churches, synagogues, and recreational facilities. Hear our prayers this day for Christ Presbyterian Church here in Lebanon. We trust and know that you go ahead of us to show us the way, a whole new way that is opening before us. Bless the officers and members with your nearness as decisions have been made and work needs to be done. Save us from being bitter or angry as we face the reality of what comes before us. We pray again for our nation on this anniversary weekend. We pray, O God, that you will be with our leaders elected and those who are serving in state and local, as well as in national governments. Help end the bickering, we pray, and the factionalism that has become so common. Give us the desire to work for the common good and to advance your will and your purpose for all people. Lay your hand upon the sick as we pray this day for Alex, and God, and family. Praying for Gary, and Helen, and Pat, and Pauline, and Verna, and others named unknown to you and to us. We also ask that you would help the unemployed who worry about buying food and paying the bills and paying the rent. And be with our young people and children in these summer months. Strengthen our parents and their responsibilities to nurture and care for their families. And now, in the confidence that you hear us, we are bold to pray as Jesus taught, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, our hymn is number 419 in the Green Presbyterian Hymnal, How Clear Is Our Vocation, Lord, verses 1 and 4. 419.
Refresh me, restore, but I have to go.
and sisters, I urge you to wear your mask, wash your hands, keep a safe distance from others, follow in the way of Jesus Christ, and the grace, mercy, and peace of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and in every tomorrow. Amen.
Thank you.